So in the early years, the line between being a company and being the government was not quite so sharp as now. And the government had to go in and start many companies because otherwise there was nobody who was doing that. We created the shipyards when the British left, Keppel and Sembawang. We had Malaysia-Singapore Airlines when we were inside Malaysia. We split from Malaysia. After some time, the airline also split up and then we formed SIA. DBS was actually started off a financing piece of EDB, and then that grew and it split off, it became a bank. Over the years, with companies big and small all over the landscape, in 1974, we put them all together and put them under Temasek Holdings. But beyond wanting it to be in one place and somewhat arm's length, actually Temasek had a role to manage the companies which were which came under them, to rationalize what they were holding, the companies which no longer made sense for the government to own, you sold off, companies which are no longer viable, make sure that they were wound up and dealt with some way, companies with promise that we would grow them and nurture them. New areas where you were not in and to go into, to choose those new areas and grow a portfolio, diversified, Singapore, in the Asian region, and in the developed world. And that part of growing Temasek to what it is now really started in earnest in 1996, when I asked Mr. Dhanabalan to become the chairman of Temasek, and he went in and he built up Temasek's headquarters, holdings, the management at Temasek, and they started working on the portfolio. And you can see the record from 1996 until now, Temasek has done well. So there's a long history which brought us here. GIC is a different history. GIC came about because MAS, the Monetary Authority, managing our foreign reserves originally, managing our exchange rate, the economy was doing well, the government was having surpluses, MAS's reserves built up. And MAS needs to keep some reserves to make sure that you can pay for your imports and to make sure that if anybody wants to take a chance and play against the Singapore dollar, you have enough ammunition to stare him down and stabilize things. But beyond that, MAS has to be very cautious because it's not MAS's main responsibility to be a fund manager. So Dr. Goh, thinking about this, decided that the fund management role should be separated from the central banking role. And we should set up a separate entity to be the government's fund manager, and the funds which MAS did not need could be taken out from MAS and parked and managed by GIC. And GIC could take a longer term view, could take greater risks, and therefore could earn much better returns than MAS would be able to do. And so in 1981, GIC was formed, and over the years, GIC has grown. It invests money for MAS. It invests money on behalf of the Ministry of Finance directly. It manages a major part of our foreign reserves and is a major part of the government's financial reserves. So there's a different history. Temasek and GIC are quite different. MAS is still there. So that's how these three pieces are there. I think in principle, yes. From time to time, we have asked ourselves, GIC, should we have two GICs? Because you have a certain amount of funds now, it's not small. Conceivably, you could have two and they could compete with one another. And then you would know who's doing well and who's not doing so well. And every few years we argue about this, but finally we'll conclude that building one team is hard enough. Let's concentrate on making that one team succeed. And I think we keep it like that. Because GIC's mandate, even more so than Temasek, is purely to manage our reserves, our financial foreign reserves, to make them grow and to protect them in downturns. You have to be invested all over the world, in America, in Europe, in China, in India, in the emerging markets. There is no investment which is guaranteed to succeed, sure win. If you think you see one which is sure win, it may be a scam. So you have to exercise judgment, you have to spread your bets, but you have to take risks. And sometimes the risks turn out well, sometimes the risks turn out badly. But if you have a competent team, if you have an honest team, if you give them the right mandate and mission, and you have the right governance process to make sure that the management of our reserves is properly done, then over a long period of time, you can be reasonably sure that the reserves will grow, and GIC has shown that. But that depends on the professionals being the right ones, that they can do their job properly and not have political interference, either because the political leaders have a view you should do this instead of that, or because the public says, why is it that investment turn went wrong, better sack the person. And unless we can shield them from these pressures, they won't be able to do their job properly, and our reserves will suffer. Well, I think it's the elected political leader's responsibility to shield them, the Prime Minister, the Minister for Finance, the Cabinet. We are answerable to Singaporeans. We are answerable to Singaporeans for the government and governance of Singapore. We are answerable for making sure that the reserves are well managed. And our response to that is, we do that by putting the right people in charge and making sure that they do the right job. My job is to be there so that there's political accountability. GIC works slightly differently from other fund management companies. In other companies, the board actually goes into individual investment decisions. In GIC's case, the board doesn't go into individual investment decisions. The board sets the overall mandate, the risk limits, and the strategy. It chooses the key people and the professionals, and there are other governance committees within GIC who then do the actual investments. That's not automatic. It hasn't always been so. After Mr. Lee Kuan Yew stepped down as Prime Minister, he remained chairman of GIC for many years, until 2011, I think. So it doesn't have to be the PM, but it must be somebody whom the PM will trust and who will carry enough weight so that the markets will know and the GIC team will know that the GIC board makes decisions on behalf of the government. I think with GIC, less so, because these are financial investments, you're more detached from them. You make a decision, well, it's a few billion dollars, but you just have to take your emotions out of it and make a judgment and sometimes take a bet. With the Temasek companies, such a situation is easier to imagine. Because if you have a bank, for example, it's easy for us to think, well, the bank should have a social purpose. And therefore, although this project doesn't really break even commercially or doesn't make a lot of financial returns, we should ask them to do it. And it can be true of a bank, it can be true of airlines, for example. You could ask it to fly somewhere where the route is not viable, but you have some diplomatic reason, you want it to go to some place. So the temptation is always there. But I think that was the reason why, in 1974, the ministers then, I suppose Dr. Goh must have been Hon Sui Sen, Lim Kim San, decided to take all these government companies out of the ministries which are overseeing them, create the Temasek Holdings, and put them into the Temasek Holdings, separate from the ministries, one remove. So that, two things. One, we don't ask the companies for favors. You are a GLC, please do this. I have a ministry's mission. Two, the company doesn't ask the ministry for favors. I'm a GLC, I have this problem, I need some government support, can you give me some special arrangements? Which happens in so many countries and is the reason why so many state-owned enterprises fail to work properly, because you lose that commercial discipline, that market discipline, because you can run to the government for special arrangements, and we wanted to not have that. And that's why we created Temasek. It is quite unusual what we have. Temasek particularly, when it comes to companies linked to the government, it's always a question. Is this part of the government? You are doing things which the government needs you to do. Or is this more a commercial operation started by the government and you should do things which make commercial sense? And here I have Temasek. I want them to contribute to Singapore and the Singapore economy and the resilience of the economy, and to have successful companies, Singtel, SIA, DBS, and so many others. And yet, I want them to operate commercially, rationally, and without political interference. And they look somewhat quizzically at me and they wonder how you can square the circle. On the one hand, you want them to have a national perspective. On the other hand, you don't want to interfere. So I say, well, the answer is, you appoint people who know what this is about, put them in charge, and trust them. And if they're not doing the right job, change them, but don't go and meddle in what is their responsibility, which is to make sure that the companies grow and prosper.